welcome to this talk by theosophical author and lecturer Kurt Leland. Kurt's topic this evening is Theosophical Resilience and the Mind of a Master. Kurt is a national lecturer for the Theosophical Society in America, specializing in the works of Annie Besant and Charles W. Leadbeater. He has edited and annotated Leadbeater's classic text, The Chakras, as well as an anthology entitled Invisible Worlds, Annie Besant on Psychic and Spiritual Development. He has also written on subjects such as astral projection, near-death experiences, and the spiritual effects of composing, performing, and listening to music. His most recent book is entitled Rainbow Body, A History of the Western Chakra System, from Blavatsky to Brennan. Last year, the British Journal for the History of Philosophy published his essay, Friendly to All Beings, Annie Besant as Ethicist. He is currently working on a reader's guide to Leadbeater's writings. Kurt currently lives in the United States in Boston, Massachusetts. He is well known to many of us as not only a very deep student of the Theosophical teachings, but also a very dear friend. Please join me in welcoming Kurt Leland to the platform for this international convention. Kurt?
Thank you, Barbara. When I saw the theme of this year's convention, Living in the Now, Challenges of the Inner Life, I immediately thought of the ways in which the COVID-19 pandemic has affected the spiritual well-being of those closest to me, my friends, family, and students. Among challenges to the inner life, such as famines, wars, earthquakes, the ravages of climate change, and repressive political regimes, this pandemic will likely be remembered by many of us as one of the most universal, deadly, and perhaps prolonged. For me, it has certainly been a lesson in resilience. For many years, I've been holding meditation classes. Each class has 5 or 6 students. We meet for 2 hours every other week, beginning with a check-in during which we share what has gone on in our lives since our previous meeting. Prior to the pandemic, we met in person in my living room. The pandemic put a stop to that. Like many such groups, including the Theosophical Society, we had to move online. Though the intended focus of my groups was self-exploration, as the pandemic wore on, I noticed that students were becoming increasingly less able to focus on our work. Their check-ins showed signs of apathy, impatience, frustration, stress, anxiety. They were often dejected or burnt out from working at home instead of an outside workplace, giving up in-person attendance of concerts, movies, and restaurants, and adopting new habits of self-care, such as wearing masks and social distancing. During our meetings, they had trouble taking in and remembering instructions. They weren't able to concentrate on the task at hand, though they often felt restored or uplifted when our time together came to a close. Such effects had worn off by our next meeting, and they were once again dejected and burnt out. Gradually, the focus of the class shifted from self-exploration to survival. Like most of us living under pandemic conditions, my students were being worn down by constant threats to their physical, emotional, mental, and spiritual well-being. At the physical level, there was fear that any trip outside the home could lead to exposure to the COVID-19 virus, with potentially devastating or deadly effects on the body. At the emotional level, there was grief over lost loved ones, family, and friends, as well as horrifying and tragic news about the pandemic's effects on other parts of the world. At the mental level, there was stress and confusion over the conflicting reports and instructions of scientists, health officials, politicians, news organizations, and social media, including misinformation and outright denials of the disease's existence. At the spiritual level, we were in danger of losing our sense that life has meaning and purpose, that there's some benevolent higher power watching over and guiding us, whether we call it soul or higher self, God, or the universe. Gradually, it became clear that the best support I could give my struggling students was to focus on resilience. The dictionary definition of this word runs as follows: the ability to recover quickly from illness, change, or misfortune. Buoyancy. The property of a material that enables it to resume its former shape or position after being bent, stretched, or compressed. Elasticity. In this definition, the words buoyancy and elasticity are of special interest. Buoyancy points in the direction of joy. How might it be possible to endure the conditions of the pandemic or any personal, familial, regional, national, or international catastrophe in a state of joy? Elasticity suggests not only adaptability, but also flexibility. What if the material being bent, stretched, or compressed was consciousness itself? How quickly could we restore our flexibility of consciousness after deformation by stress or trauma to its former state of buoyancy or joy? These questions have guided me during the pandemic, not only in my personal life, but also in the work I've done with students. They've led me to identify a number of things that reduce our resilience, our flexibility of consciousness, and some methods of restoring resilience, of returning our consciousness to its former state of buoyancy or joy. For example, in March 2019, when the pandemic was declared, the first requirement for each of us was to move from ignorance to knowledgeability about what we were up against. We had to learn how COVID-19 was transmitted, what its symptoms were, and how deadly it could be. Meanwhile, the international scientific and medical communities were rushing to acquire and pass on this unknown but essential information. We had to learn what precautions to take and overcome personal resistance to the extraordinary measures of wearing masks and social distancing whenever we left our homes. Both in the news and among my family, friends, and students, I noticed that those who willingly gathered and acted upon such information tended to be more resilient than those who resisted or rejected it. In a similar way, people who reacted to the pandemic by asking themselves what they could learn and how they could grow and thrive under such conditions tended to be more resilient than those who reacted with shock, overwhelm, or denial. On the internet, I've read numerous stories about people who have protested the changes demanded by public health and governmental bodies. Trying to maintain or return to a previous state of normalcy, such people were often seething with resentment over having to wear masks and social distance. Right or wrong in advocating the sovereignty of individual rights over government-mandated civic duties, their resentment seemed to reduce their resilience. Doing the opposite of what was required of them, they were often unable to protect themselves and their families from the hard lessons of contagion. I wondered whether a choice of equanimity over resentment could have helped them maintain their autonomy while making wiser, less damaging choices. Month by month, I came to understand that the greatest threat to our resilience cuts across the boundaries of differing political philosophies to affect us all. Let's call it despair versus endurance. During the pandemic, we've had to change our personal and social behavior so extremely and for such a long period of time that it's easy to fall into the belief that the pandemic will never end. Periodically, I've heard people say, "I'm just done with this pandemic." But the pandemic isn't over yet. The endurance of such people has crashed, and with it, their resilience. They're likely to make unsafe choices in an attempt to restore what they see as a pre-pandemic golden age of personal and social freedom. Throughout these troubled times, my exploration of the questions of what reduces resilience and what restores it has been guided by theosophical teachings, especially a passage written by our second international president, Annie Besant, in 1896. In this passage, she attempts to describe the mind of one who has achieved a superhuman level of evolutionary development, a being that our literature calls a master of the wisdom. The consciousness of the master stretches itself out in any direction in which he sends it, assimilates itself with any point to which he directs it, knows anything which he wills to know, and all this in order that he may help perfectly, that there may be nothing that he cannot feel, nothing that he cannot foster, nothing that he cannot strengthen, nothing that he cannot aid in its evolution. To him, the whole world is one vast evolving whole, and his place in it is that of a helper of evolution. He is able to identify himself with any step, and at that step, to give the aid that is needed. Most of us are likely to think of the mind of a master as something achievable only after scores of lifetimes. Even though our literature is rife with books that outline the steps necessary to approach such a state, for example, Annie Besant's In the Outer Court and The Path of Discipleship, the magnitude of the endeavor seems overwhelming and the goal beyond our reach. But what if we thought about her description of the mind of the master as a definition of ideal resilience, an adaptability that allows us to know what to do next under any set of circumstances? In the Outer Court, Besant has spoken of the mind of the master in terms of boundless compassion, infinite strength, radiant joy, and uttermost peace. This combination of qualities, she says, is the ideal that one day we shall become. The method of achieving this ideal is self-sacrifice, also known as selfless service. For, as Besant says, life is meant for service and not for self-seeking. Let's think of compassion, strength, joy, and peace as concomitants of ideal resilience. As we develop these qualities, we approach the mind of the master. But let's not seek such qualities for our own sake. During troubled times, such as the present pandemic, our task should be to develop and maintain our resilience for the sake of helping others do the same. Using the mind of the master as our ideal, let's explore this specifically theosophical brand of resilience. I believe it could best be described in the following phrase: joyful, compassionate equanimity in service. Joyful, compassionate equanimity in service. Our literature abounds in impressive, quotable maxims. These are often brought forward on our lecture platforms and in our journals, something in the manner of "the glory that is us," or "hurrah, theosophy." They tell us how the world should be and perhaps also how we should be in the world. But rarely have I seen them plumbed for the advice and consolation they could provide in troubled times as a means of promoting ideal resilience. Take, for example, The Three Truths from the Idyll of the White Lotus, an inspired novel by Mabel Collins. These are glorious, resounding statements of vitally important spiritual principles. They impress us with every hearing or reading, yet they're almost too resonant to be examined, and the power of the teachings they contain may not be fully grasped or tapped. Here's the first of these truths. The soul of man is immortal, and his future is a thing whose growth and splendor has no limit. Shouldn't we be asking ourselves, where's the growth during this pandemic, and where's the splendor? How tempted are we to bury our heads in the sand and wait till the crisis passes? Yet resilience requires that we consent to be in the body, on the planet, in the midst of a pandemic, or a war, or an unjust regime. Otherwise, our resilience falters, even with our heads in the sand. We have to show up and be fully present to ourselves and to others. During such times, if we happen to ask, where's the splendor? We'll probably answer, nowhere. Yet resilience requires that we see splendor somewhere, or we lose faith in God, soul, humanity. I suggest that the growth experienced during troubled times develops from watching and participating in a sense of emerging brotherhood. And the splendor develops from our amazement over witnessing examples of what could be called achieved unity consciousness, even if brief or temporary. By this phrase, I mean such things as the local, national, and international outpouring of support for the victims of natural disasters, such as earthquakes, hurricanes, and floods, or the humanitarian aid provided by NGOs, non-governmental organizations, in regions devastated by war, pestilence, and famine. Certainly, during the pandemic, we've seen doctors and nurses lay down their lives. They've been first responders to the seriously ill in the midst of the unknown dangers posed by a deadly, newly discovered virus. We've also seen laboratories throughout the world devoting time, energy, and funding toward the study of this virus, attempting to discover means for caring for those infected and best practices for preventing infection. Of course, there has also been non-cooperation and obfuscation, especially by local and national governments seeking to suppress statistics concerning positive cases of COVID-19 and deaths from the disease. The news media have tended to focus on such failures, promoting resentment, anxiety, despair. To maintain resilience, we need to focus instead on the splendid sacrifice of those who have united in a mission to save individuals, cities, states, countries, and humanity itself from the ravages of COVID-19. That's what I mean by achieved unity consciousness. Let's go on to examine the second of the three truths. The principle which gives life wells in us and without us, is undying and eternally beneficent, is not heard or seen or smelt, but is perceived by the man who desires perception. We call this principle by a variety of names, including God, soul, peace, and joy. But where or how do we find such things within and without us? I would suggest that we find them within us through turning inward by some means of peace-inspiring meditation. We find them without us by turning outward to contemplate and appreciate the divine beauty in nature and other beings. The secret of theosophical resilience is to stay in touch with this principle that gives life, whether we call it God, soul, peace, or joy, Otherwise, we lose our endurance and are reduced to despair. Let's turn now to the last of the three truths. Each man is his own absolute lawgiver, the dispenser of glory or gloom to himself, the decreer of his life, his reward, his punishment. Clearly, this truth refers to what we call the law of karma, also known as the moral law of action and reaction, or of cause and effect. Perusing our ample literature on this subject, for example, Annie Besant's book entitled Karma, we quickly find a virtually unanimous response. Selfishness produces gloom and/or karmic punishment. Unselfishness produces glory and/or karmic reward. Naturally, a further question arises. How can we get through troubled times in glory or joy instead of gloom? For illumination here, let's turn to The Key to Theosophy by our revered co-founder, H.P. Blavatsky. In this textbook of theosophical ethics, HPB outlines several aims of theosophy. The first is the relief of human suffering under any or every form, moral as well as physical. She claims that moral suffering is the more important of the two. Another aim is to inculcate ethics, and a third, to purify the soul. I've often wondered whether suffering is the right word in such a context. The Buddha taught that all life is suffering. If so, then the theosophical task of relieving suffering would be daunting, if not overwhelming. Where do we begin? I know good-hearted people, both inside and outside the Theosophical Society, who are virtually paralyzed by the amount of suffering in the world and the question of what to do about it. That's not resilience. What would happen if we exchange the word suffering with need or needfulness? I think it would be true to say that the entire world exists in a state of needfulness. It also seems that once a genuine need has been satisfied, it vanishes from our awareness, though it will certainly be replaced by others. True needs, such as those for water, food, clothing, shelter, and maintenance of health, are always specific, and suffering always results when they're not satisfied. Besides these physical needs, there are emotional needs, including comfort when we grieve, mental needs, including literacy and education, and spiritual needs, including belief in the existence and guidance of higher powers, such as the soul, God, or other angelic or divine beings. Wherever our physical, emotional, mental, and spiritual needs may require money to be satisfied, there are also true financial needs and the suffering that results from financial insecurity. One way of relieving suffering without producing overwhelm in ourselves might be to determine the nature of another's need and attempt to provide what's needed, one need at a time. This is what Annie Besant means when she says that the master is able to identify himself with any step and at that step to give the aid that is needed. Let's return to HBB's claims about the aims of theosophy. What does she mean by the phrase inculcation of ethics? My understanding is that theosophical ethics involves what Annie Besant calls being friendly to all beings. For example, in her advanced textbook of Hindu religion and ethics, she advocates a system of establishing right relations with all beings, physical and non-physical, from whatever we call God, the source of all being, through lesser gods or powers, such as angels or devas, to humans, animals, the plant world, and the substances that make up our physical environment, including air, fire, water, and earth. for Besan, right relations develop from ahimsa, a Sanskrit word often translated as non-harming. To be friendly to all beings, we must be kind in thought, word, and deed as an expression of non-harming. We must also be kind to ourselves, eschewing negative thoughts and self-judgment, as well as actions that would undermine our physical, emotional, and psychological health. Non-harming may also require a willingness to sacrifice ourselves in some way to promote the well-being and evolution of others. For example, by sharing time, energy, and financial resources in ways that promote others' growth. But let's not rescue others by martyring ourselves. That's not resilience. Unless we're called by exceptional circumstances to lay down our lives, it's enough to show people how to restore their own resilience. Again, the mind of the master sets the bar. We evolve by becoming helpers of evolution and not by destroying ourselves as potential future sources of help. If the world is indeed one vast evolving whole, it includes everyone, even us. Through the practice of non-harming, we study this evolving world, gradually discovering our special place within and contribution to that evolution. If we're able to make this service-based contribution in joy, compassion, and equanimity, people might ask us not only what we're doing, but also why and how we do it. Explaining the nature of theosophical resilience to such inquirers would fulfill HPB's aim of inculcation of ethics. What does HPB mean by the phrase purification of the soul? The simplest answer to this question is progressive removal of what she elsewhere calls the great heresy, the separateness of soul or self from the one universal infinite self. Annie Besant explains this process in terms of developing an ever more expansive set of ethics. Thus we rise through what she calls family, social, national, and international morality. Eventually, we achieve inter-world morality, which includes our relations not only with people who have died, in particular, our own ancestors, but also with the minerals, plants, animals, nature spirits, angels, devas, and gods of this world and its associated non-physical planes. Thus, the inculcation of ethics within us is a means of purification of soul. We set our aim on unity consciousness, the recognition of oneself in all beings. Gradually, we remove everything that stands in the way of embodying this state of unity. As Besant puts it, we shall see, as we study morality, that all its precepts are founded on this unity of the self. Further illumination on the question of getting through the present pandemic or some other catastrophe and glory versus gloom comes from the well-known three objects of the Theosophical Society. They were cited at the beginning of our lodge and study group meetings and printed prominently in our journals, but we may not have realized what they could teach us about ideal resilience. The first object is to form a nucleus of the universal brotherhood of humanity without distinction of race, creed, sex, caste, or color. Consider all the suffering that has been caused by non-inclusiveness along these lines, as well as others, such as sexual orientation and gender identity. Any effort we make to create a warm and welcoming nucleus of universal brotherhood could fulfill one of HPB's aims of theosophy, relief of human suffering, physical and moral. Let's take on the challenge of becoming friendly to all beings in thought, feeling, word, and action by practicing non-harming and inclusivity in every way. This is one path to achieving the ideal resilience represented by the mind of the master. To paraphrase Besant, such a task teaches us how to help perfectly, so there may be nothing we cannot feel, nothing we cannot foster, nothing we cannot strengthen, nothing we cannot aid in its evolution. Our second object, to encourage the study of comparative religion, philosophy, and science, comes under the heading of inculcation of ethics. We study such literature, including theosophical literature, to learn about and develop right relations with God or the gods, masters and angels, humanity, and the other physical and non-physical kingdoms inhabiting our planet. Equally important is passing on the results of our studies to others, not perhaps by buttonholing them, but by recommending books that have been helpful in clarifying our ethics and answering questions about right thought, feeling, or action under a variety of inwardly and outwardly challenging circumstances. In this way, we might support them in discovering or returning to the buoyancy and adaptability required by troubled times, thus passing on to them our own resilience. On social media and elsewhere on the internet, I've seen accusations by some theosophical groups that our members indulge in too much study and don't focus enough on practical service. The same accusation comes up in The Key to Theosophy. Let's see how HPB addresses it. Inquirer, but all this literature, to the spread of which you attach so much importance, does not seem to me of much practical use in helping mankind. This is not practical charity. Theosophist, we think otherwise. We hold that a good book, which gives people food for thought, which strengthens and clears their minds, and enables them to grasp truths which they have dimly felt but could not formulate. We hold that such a book does a real, substantial good. Of course, we must know which books are good and the ways in which they're good. We can only gain that knowledge by extensive reading in our literature while engaging in comparative study of how contemporary science, religion, and philosophy are dealing with age-old personal, social, and spiritual problems. Nor should we neglect spiritual and philosophical classics, such as the Bhagavad Gita or the Bible, which are full of good counsel and consolation during troubled times and can thus promote our own and others' resilience. Sadly, our third object, to investigate unexplained laws of nature and the powers latent in humanity, is often neglected because of a basic misunderstanding of its meaning and application. Such investigation is frequently derided as the pursuit of psychic powers or the practice of magic, which are deemed useless in the promotion of universal brotherhood. My view is that our third object is intended to promote the purification of soul to the point that we're able to achieve compassionate joy or joyful compassion. This is the bliss of unity consciousness, of seeing the one self in all things and all things in oneself. It's achieved through stripping away all the selfishness that obscures this sense of oneness, both through meditation and selfless service. Thus we rise through expanding levels of morality, from concern for our family's well-being to that for all creatures, physical and non-physical. All laws of nature and all latent powers in humanity have their origin and explanation in the one self. The investigation of the one self in all is the true goal of our third object. When that's our aim, we can't help but experience bleed-throughs of Annie Besant's inter-world morality, such as perceiving and communicating with deceased persons or non-physical beings. We're safe if we do so while developing the compassionate joy of unity consciousness, also called buddhi or spiritual intuition. The compassionate joy of buddhi as not only the greatest power latent in humanity, but also the key to theosophical resilience. It's what makes relief of human suffering possible. Without it, we're overwhelmed and even paralyzed by the suffering we see in the world. All the more so when we include the suffering of animals and the environment. Let's consider now how self-sacrifice relates to ideal resilience. Throughout her theosophical career, Annie Besant spoke of the polarity of life and form. Life is consciousness, spiritual. Form is matter, material. Life takes on and expresses itself through form. Thus, we have something that could be called a soul, life, expressing itself through a body, form. Forms, Besant teaches, are meant to be broken. Do not let the form constrain the life, she says. We should let the life grow. Furthermore, if the form is still useful, the life will make it more helpful. If your inner life has outgrown its forms, the inner life will reform it. This, of course, is the adaptability required of us during troubled times. Besant continues, if you have thoroughly outgrown it, the form, the inner life will break it. What Besant doesn't say here is that when forms are broken, the consciousness within them is liberated into a larger life and form. One example, of course, is the after-death life experienced in the paradisal realm we theosophists call Devachan. During any catastrophe, such as the present pandemic, forms are broken. I don't mean merely that people lose their lives in their present physical body. The form of daily life may also be broken, as when a flood or earthquake interrupts delivery of essential needs, such as food, water, fuel, or electricity, or destroys a house or village. Social forms too may be broken, as in the case of travel restrictions, lockdowns, and social distancing, things we've had to endure during this pandemic. What I've seen in my meditation students is that their resilience or lack of it depends on how quickly they're able to let go of broken forms. If they cling to these forms, their resilience is lowered. If they let go of such clinging, it rebounds. What happens when they let go of clinging? First, they're consenting to the new conditions of their growth. Second, liberation from old forms and from clinging to them opens up new possibilities of thought, feeling, and action, even if, in the beginning, they're primarily focused on survival. Before long, they may discover how to thrive under these new conditions. One aspect of this thriving develops from helping others adapt to the emerging new normal. Compassion arises from seeing how others are challenged by such changes, by seeing how their resilience suffers from clinging to broken forms. How might it be possible to reach them, turning their present state of shock and paralysis into flow? Finding an appropriate next step may contribute to relief and joy on both sides, even in the midst of grieving over what was lost. Our task is to teach resilience by our own example. We can do this best by sacrificing our tendency to cling to broken forms. And the joy that results from liberating ourselves into a larger life, we look for a step that someone who's less resilient may take to overcome their clinging. This is the smaller self sacrificed on the altar of the larger self for the sake of humanity. This, I believe, is the gift we're offered whenever we experience a personal, regional, national, or international tragedy or catastrophe. Not only do we sacrifice ourselves for the sake of others, we're also liberated into a larger life. We get closer to source. Our joy, our capacity to serve others with resilience, each continually increases. we're approaching the mind of the master. And if, in the midst of personal and worldwide devastation and loss of life, we remind ourselves again and again that forms are broken to liberate consciousness into a larger life, even as we grieve, we may avoid the danger of losing our endurance to despair. In closing, I would like to recommend some guidelines for achieving the ideal of theosophical resilience I've put before you: joyful, compassionate, equanimity, and service. First, let's keep Annie Besant's description of the consciousness of the master constantly before us. Thus, there should be nothing we cannot feel on behalf of humanity. However, we'll not only need compassion, but also equanimity in order not to be overwhelmed by human suffering. Let's also remember the challenge posed by the third great truth of Mabel Collins: how to live from glory instead of gloom in the midst of troubled times. Let's be attentive to the glory of what it means to be human: unexpected moments of achieved unity consciousness played out on a local, regional, national, or international stage. Let there be nothing we cannot foster, strengthen, or aid in its evolution. This task, of course, will be a perpetual work in progress. My personal formula for undertaking such a task is fourfold. First, show up in compassion. Second, be fully present in equanimity. Third, be kind to yourself and others in service. Fourth, find a step to take or a need to fulfill in joy. Often, that step is as simple as letting people know they're seen, heard, understood, and valued. Something they say may be the right next step for them in resolving their problems. Our task is to listen for it and highlight it when it comes. In this way, we approach the mind of the master as a helper of evolution. Meanwhile, we're constantly working to achieve the joy of unity consciousness in ourselves by seeing the entire world as one vast evolving whole. Without that joy, we won't have the strength and endurance to get through a prolonged crisis, such as the present pandemic. Finally, by means of selfless service, we learn how to identify the physical, emotional, mental, spiritual, and financial needs that cause suffering in others, and discover the step that allows us to give the aid that's needed. Thus do we live in the now, while sacrificing all clinging to the past. Thus do we navigate the challenges to our inner life posed by this now, and whatever new normal arises from it. Thus do we implement the ideal of theosophical resilience that I call joyful, compassionate, equanimity, and service. Thank you for your attention, and thank you to the organizing committee of this day's talks for the opportunity to speak on the subject of living in the now, challenges of the inner life.
Thank you so much. You have given us all a great deal to ponder over the coming days, weeks, and months about how we are living in this difficult time. Thank you so much, Kurt, and thanks to all of you for being a part of this program. Welcome. I have the great honor and privilege of introducing the speaker for this afternoon, Teresa Ayala. Teresa is an architect who specializes in social impact buildings, such as shelters for children and welfare houses for adults. She has also worked in the area of the anthropology of art linked with theosophy, mainly with children participating in projects that allow for reconstruction of the social fabric of the community. Teresa has been a member of the Theosophical Society since 2003 and was co-founder of the Damodar KM Lodge in 2017. She is involved with the Theosophical Order of Service, especially in the field of animal defense and the dissemination of vegetarianism. Today, Teresa will talk with us about the topic of the celestial man. Welcome, Teresa.
HPV, perspectivas sobre la vida interna, el hombre celeste. La clasificación septenaria del hombre, mostrada bajo la luz de la teosofía, no es una visión técnica, sino una visión filosófica y científica arcana, que nos enseña lo que es el hombre, posicionándolo justo en su sitio con todo un potencial que no es abstracto, sino concreto y posible, permitiéndole acceder al hombre cósmico. La pregunta es, ¿cómo? Cuando se dice que la teosofía es filosofía, ciencia y religión, desde luego que no se refiere a la ciencia que se descubre actualmente, o peor aún, a la que se inventa actualmente. Esto lo deja muy claro William Q. Judge en su libro Ecos de Oriente, en el que menciona todas las limitaciones de la ciencia actual misma, que no cree en el alma de las cosas. Este paréntesis es necesario para comprender de dónde viene esta tradición a la que nosotros llamamos teosofía. La perspectiva de Blavatsky, cuyo sustento es la tradición heredada por una larga serie de rishis y videntes de las razas que nos han precedido y de la cual ella misma ha formado parte, implica al mismo tiempo cumplir una expectativa, la teosófica. En la revista El Loto, volumen 3, del 16 de julio de 1888, publicación teosófica editada por la logia Isis de París, HPV nos presenta a través de la visión egipcia un esbozo de lo que es el hombre. Nos explica que toda la naturaleza es aquello manifestado en múltiples formas y con diversos grados de desarrollo, siendo justo la forma humana la mitad de tal recorrido de manifestación. En la cosmovisión egipcia, la Génesis expone que en el principio era el caos, simbolizado por el dios Nun. Por lo tanto, el universo no ha sido creado, existía desde la eternidad. En ese tiempo, no existían aún el cielo, ni la tierra, ni los hombres. Los dioses aún no habían nacido. Aún no existía la muerte. En este caos, Atum, cuyo nombre significa el todo o el completo, el espíritu del mundo, estaba diluido. Llevaba en sí la fuerza generadora de los seres y de las cosas. Al tomar conciencia de sí mismo, se desdobló y dio nacimiento al dios Ra, personificado por el sol. Atum y Ra, el espíritu del mundo y su conciencia, son los dos aspectos de un solo ser, mundo invisible que lleva en sí la fuerza generadora de su propia sustancia. En el capítulo 17 del libro de los muertos se describe la creación como la cumplió Ra. Cuando abriste los ojos y viste por ellos, se hizo la luz para todo el mundo. Ra es la luz del mundo, el primer elemento de la creación que surge después de las tinieblas del caos. la creación realizada por la vista y por la palabra de Ra, es recordada en este mismo capítulo, en estos términos. El hombre ha salido del ojo del Creador, cual una lágrima. Los dioses han sido emitidos por su boca. Es entonces que a partir del hombre, o mejor dicho, de la forma humana, hemos de manera volitiva de recorrer el resto del circuito. La tradición oculta nos responde afirmativamente, mostrándonos todo el potencial accesible a nuestro entender a partir de poseer un cerebro humano, vehículo del principio pensante. Como todos sabemos, cada entidad o principio tiene una correspondencia con algún órgano de este complejo sistema que llamamos cuerpo físico. En el artículo que cita Blavatsky, refiriéndose al libro de los muertos y a la escena que trata la llegada del difunto a los campos elíseos o de Anru, después de haber sido sometido al juicio, este es nombrado al fin el embellecido o espiritual. Los ministros de Osiris le han llevado a la granja o lugar de residencia que le había sido asignado por orden de Osiris. Y allí comenzó su nueva existencia. La gran viñeta del capítulo 14 nos muestra exactamente qué lugar era la morada de los bienaventurados. El país era llano y los campos estaban cruzados por canales de agua corriente en los que no había peces ni gusanos. En una parte había varias islas pequeñas y en una de ellas se suponía que Osiris vivía con sus santos. Se le llamó la Isla de la Verdad y el barquero de Osiris no le transmitía ningún alma que no hubiese sido declarada verdadera de palabra por Tot. Osiris y los grandes dioses, en el gran ajuste de cuentas, hacían de esta alma una embellecida. La porción del reino de Osiris, representada en los grandes libros de los muertos, muestra en muchos aspectos una típica granja egipcia. Y vemos a los difuntos dedicados a arar, cosechar y conducir los bueyes que están trillando el trigo. Fue introducido en el también llamado campo de juncos por Tot, y allí encontró las almas de sus antepasados, que se unieron a la compañía de los dioses. Un rincón de esta región estaba especialmente apartado para la morada de las almas embellecidas o almas espirituales, que se decía que tenían 7 codos de altura, y para cosechar trigo o cebada, que crecía a una altura de 3 codos. Cerca de este lugar estaban amarradas 2 barcas siempre dispuestas para el uso de los habitantes de esa región. Parecen haber sido barcas espirituales, es decir, barcas que se movían por sí mismas transportando a los embellecidos. Los embellecidos o almas verdaderas se ocupan de producir el alimento celestial del que vivían ellos y el dios. Algunos se muestran cuidando las plantas de trigo a medida que crecen y otros están cosechando el grano maduro. En los textos que acompañan a estas escenas se dice que las espigas de trigo son los miembros de Osiris y la planta de trigo se llama planta Maat. Osiris era el dios del trigo y también la personificación de Maat, es decir, la verdad. Y los embellecidos vivían del cuerpo de su dios y lo comían a diario. Y la sustancia de él era el pan de la eternidad, que se menciona en los textos de las pirámides. Los embellecidos se describen como aquellos que han ofrecido incienso a los dioses, cuyos errores han sido lavados, han sido contados y son Maat, es decir, la verdad, en presencia del gran Dios que destruye el pecado. Una vez que Osiris les ha dicho, vosotros sois verdad de verdad, descansa en paz. Y de ellos se dice, fueron hacedores de la verdad mientras estaban en la tierra. lucharon por su Dios y serán llamados al disfrute de la tierra de la casa de la vida con la verdad. Su verdad será contada a ellos en la presencia del gran Dios que destruye el pecado. Luego, dirigiéndose a ellos nuevamente, Osiris dice: vosotros sois seres de verdad. Oh, vosotros, verdades, descansad por lo que habéis hecho, volviéndonos iguales a los que me siguen y que dirigen la casa de aquel cuya alma es santa. Viviréis allí como ellos viven y tendréis dominio sobre las frescas aguas de vuestra tierra. Yo ordeno que tengáis vuestro ser hasta el límite de esa tierra con la verdad y sin pecado. En estos pasajes tenemos bien ilustradas las dos concepciones de Osiris. Como el dios del trigo satisfaría a aquellos que deseaban un cielo puramente material y agrícola, donde el hambre sería desconocida. El nombre del artículo del que hacemos mención es Psicología del Antiguo Egipto. Notas importantes por HPB. En este, Blavatsky se refiere a la transcripción de una tableta egipcia que representa la llegada del difunto a los campos elíseos o campos de Aru. En esta bella metáfora, en forma de himno cargado de simbolismo, se expone de manera oculta la clasificación septenaria. Cuando es descrito por las divinidades y los difuntos una vez que han sido embellecidos, y dicen: conozco ese campo de Anru, con cercado de hierro, en donde la cebada tiene 7 codos de altura, su espiga tiene 3 codos, su tallo tiene 4. Es entonces que Blavatsky asegura que son la corroboración más brillante de los 7 principios del hombre que uno pueda encontrar en la religión esotérica del Antiguo Egipto. En la explicación, comienza haciendo una analogía de cada estado o plano donde ha de conducirse el difunto por el fruto de sus buenas y malas obras, y menciona: el campo de Anru es el de Bachán, la cebada sembrada y recolectada por el difunto, y que tiene 7 codos de altura, representa el karma sembrado y recolectado por los 7 principios del muerto durante su vida. La espiga que tiene 3 codos es la tríada superior. Los 4 codos, el tallo o la paja, son los 4 principios inferiores. Ella explica lo que el hombre es, iniciando con la tríada superior, integrada por Atman, Budi y el aroma de Manas, representada por un triángulo con el ápice hacia arriba. Se refiere después a los 4 principios inferiores como Kama Rupa, la forma astral, el principio vital y el cuerpo físico, desde luego, mencionando que el hombre siempre se ha estado representando en los símbolos geométricos: el triángulo, el cuadrado y finalmente en una composición en forma de cruz, formada de cuadrados a manera de cubo desdoblado, misma a la que los egipcios colocaban un círculo en la parte superior y le llamaban cruz ansada. Es justo esta imagen que ella menciona, que esta cruz con el círculo en la parte superior representa al hombre. El círculo o el asa que corona la tau es una cabeza humana, significando el hombre crucificado en el espacio de Platón, o el Vítoba de los indos. Y aquí, HPB nos ha hecho una recomendación, una invitación: indagar sobre el Vítoba. Y para eso es necesario consultar una obra llamada El Panteón Hindú, de Edvard Moore, un tratado temprano en idioma inglés acerca del hinduismo, al que ella cita en algunos artículos que actualmente forman parte de los Collected Writings y que fue escrito en 1810. La palabra Vítoba proviene del sánscrito y significa aquel que está de pie sobre un ladrillo. Erguido, mostrando a un hombre que se levanta sobre sí mismo. Otro significado atribuido es aquel que acepta gente inocente que ha sido desprovista de conocimiento. Se hace mención también a su relación con Vishnu y Krishna y con su vocación de Dios pastoral. Por ello, en algunas localidades de la India, se le honra aún como un héroe dios que ofreció su vida para salvar a su ganado como buen pastor. Como podemos ver, la metáfora del buen pastor es mucho más antigua de lo que nos parece, así como su amplio significado. Por estos atributos es que Vitoba es asociado con la compasión, el amor infinito, la ternura hacia sus bhaktas, devotos. Por ello, es el benefactor de los pobres y necesitados. La imagen también es honrada con una marca en forma de aro sobre su pecho derecho, que representa la morada de Sri. Además, posee un cinturón de 3 codos que refiere a las virtudes despertadas. Nuevamente, la iconografía se hace presente en figuras poco más recientes en Occidente. En la metáfora de la perspectiva, puede observarse que a partir de un punto de fuga en la distancia, se obtiene una nueva forma de percibir aquello que es. Las culturas antiguas no usaban este método de representar la realidad, ya que solo representaban 2 dimensiones. Es a partir del siglo XIV que esta nueva forma de reinterpretar lo que se mira comienza a proliferar. Justo Blavatsky es un ejemplo de traer del pasado de ese hilo conductor que se proyecta en el futuro a través de la iconografía y del simbolismo en nuevas miradas de la tradición. Este método fue llamado método analógico. Devolviéndonos a los estados después de la muerte, cuando Blavatsky expone el significado de la tríada superior y se refiere a manas, o mejor dicho, el aroma de manas, en el proceso inverso, es decir, la muerte o la descorporificación, ella explica el destino de estos 3 principios de la siguiente manera. En cuanto a la tríada superior, ella deja el cuaternario inferior y el espíritu con su vehículo, el alma divina, acompañados del aroma espiritual de manas, reunidos en la unidad del sin mortal, para encontrarse en el divino estado de Devachán. Por otro lado, el destino final del resto de los otros 3 vehículos o entidades es bastante desolador, puesto que HPB explica que estos, llamados ahora el alma animal, no conserva de la parte inferior de manas más que lo suficiente del instinto para buscar a mediums o vampirizar. Su destino es de evaporarse un día. Hasta entonces no vive más que de la inteligencia de los vivos, que son lo suficientemente débiles para dejarse poseer. Es por lo tanto una miserable vida prestada. Es en este sentido que Madame Blavatsky hace énfasis en el principio manas. El término proviene de la lengua antigua de los Gujarats y la raíz de este man, que significa pensar. Es justo este principio el que marca la diferencia no solo durante la vida, sino también al terminar esta, justo cuando se ha dejado el cuerpo físico. El destino de todas las entidades inevitablemente se ve involucrado por el uso que hayamos hecho del pensar. Indudablemente, al ilustrar la explicación del hombre celeste con la figura del Vitoba, ella nos muestra que es posible acercarnos a una divinidad tangible como experiencia colectiva, abriendo la posibilidad por decisión propia de acercarnos a esos principios superiores a través de nuestras decisiones y actos en los cuales todos estamos involucrados, comprendiendo a la manifestación como una experiencia en la que todo reino evoluciona únicamente en plena colaboración mutua. Entiéndase entonces que el llamado progreso no es la búsqueda de la autorrealización en solitario. Una de las premisas teosóficas es justamente la de crear un núcleo de la fraternidad universal como una expectativa derivada precisamente de la carencia de esta. Algunos miembros comienzan en la sociedad teosófica con la idea de que esta fraternidad ya existe, sin notar que es justo el primero de los objetivos del plan original de la fundación de la sociedad. ¿Qué es aquello que a nuestros días pareciera obstaculizar la creación de ese núcleo de la fraternidad universal? En las primeras publicaciones de la clasificación septenaria mostradas a Occidente, una constante preocupación era la falta de comprensión de esta, debido al materialismo de la época, mismo que se reflejaba en el culto a la personalidad o aquello que habrá de desmoronarse inevitablemente. El hombre celeste es el hombre interno hacia el que habrá de retraerse una vez después de abandonar la morada física, el aroma de las buenas obras que implican el comprender el significado de la impermanencia de la personalidad y asumir la importancia de nuestras obras en nuestra colectividad, como ya lo hemos visto. El trabajo, el quehacer del estudiante de teosofía, es dejar de parecer un teósofo, aproximarse al teósofo para serlo. La clave de la teosofía es justo la obra de HPD que nos muestra el camino a través de comprender esta gran tradición que nos ha heredado la larga serie de Runshis y videntes, incluida Blavatsky.
Hola hermanos y hermanos, bienvenidos. Mi nombre es Eneida Elena Carbonell Irarragorri, miembro de la Logia España Teosófica aquí en Los Ángeles, California. Hoy vamos a considerar algunas de las enseñanzas teosóficas que la señora Blavatsky nos dejó, así como acontecimientos de su vida que le hicieron la fervorosa maestra madre de la teosofía. La calidad de su carácter, su indomable coraje, altruismo y sinceridad, así como el sacrificio de sus más elevadas facultades y energías en la búsqueda del verdadero conocimiento o sabiduría divina y en beneficio del avance moral, intelectual y espiritual de la humanidad, es inspirador y una definitiva invitación a que podamos percibir las realidades de la vida interna. Aquí vemos un cuadro de HPB que se encuentra en la logia de La Habana, Cuba, el cual ha estado ahí por muchos años. Me acuerdo desde niña haberlo visto cuando mis padres me llevaban junto con mis hermanos a la logia de La Habana. Para mí siempre fue acogedor ver esta imagen de HPB, tan gentil, dulce y cariñosa, reflejando la luz de un conocimiento verdadero y poderoso, compartiéndolo con sus hermanos teósofos, con sus hijos en la teosofía, con toda la progenie que es la humanidad. El himno que sigue a continuación es cantado por los miembros de diferentes logias en América Latina. Nosotros en la Logia España lo entonamos en celebraciones tales como la fundación de la Sociedad Teosófica en noviembre 17 de cada año, cuando recordamos a sus fundadores Henry Steele Olcott y la señora Blavatsky. Dice así, el himno dice así: Salve Blavatsky, que la unidad proclamas. base de puro amor, que es vida limpia y mente veraz. Danos más luz, que la visión eleve, cual rayo de esperanza y de fraternidad. La evolución con la ley de karma brilla en todo el cosmos, según nos revelas, en las estrellas, en los minerales, en el ángel sabio y en el hombre también. Salve Blavatsky, que la unidad proclamas, base de puro amor, que es vida limpia y mente veraz. Danos más luz, que la visión eleve, cual rayo de esperanza y de felicidad. Este himno es muy significativo, pues en unas pocas estrofas da la visión teosófica sobre la unidad de la vida, la fraternidad que es base de puro amor y la ley evolutiva y kármica a que están sujetos todos los reinos. Ahora vamos a ver unos pasajes de una carta de HPB que desde Nueva York le envió a su tía Nadine Padip en Odessa sobre el año 1877, cuando se publica su libro Isis sin velos. He estado pensando todo el tiempo, dice ella, y he decidido al fin escribirte toda la verdad, tal cual es. Te voy a mostrar todo mi ser interno, mi alma, mi corazón y mi cerebro, venga lo que venga. Si me entiendes, gracias a Dios, el destino me ha favorecido. Si no me entiendes y te enojas, eso me entristecería mucho y me preocuparía. En otro mundo, en otra vida futura, donde ciertamente nos volveremos a encontrar, todo se aclararía y conoceríamos quién está en lo correcto y quién no. Pero mientras tanto, como ambas somos sinceras y obedecemos nuestras conciencias y no engañamos a nadie por miedo o por falta de valentía, aun cuando podamos estar erradas en nuestras calculaciones, en nuestras esperanzas y creencias, aún así seguimos siendo personas honestas. Si tú fueras la Madame Gang o ese tonto Romanov, que eran personas de la aristocracia rusa relacionados con el zar, no te hubiera dicho estas cosas, pero tú sabes que tú eres súper inteligente y que eres mucho más aprendida que yo, pues tu aprendizaje es la sólida emanación de tu propio cerebro y entendimiento. Y lo mío es hereditario. Yo soy solo el reflejo de una desconocida y brillante luz. Como quiera que eso sea, esta luz ha sido gradualmente incorporada en mí, filtrada en mí, traspasando a través de mí y por lo tanto, no puedo contenerme al ver que todas estas ideas que han llegado a mi mente también han llegado a lo más profundo de mi alma. Soy sincera, pero quizás esté equivocada. Aquí podemos notar el afecto y la sinceridad de HPB para con su tía y también la apertura de su alma en esperanza a que ese conocimiento iluminativo que ella recibió pueda igualmente servirle a su tía y quizás a otros también. Continuamos. Dice ella, este largo prefacio es debido a que tú y mi tío, por tener buen corazón y sentimientos de familia, quieren tener dos copias de mi libro, Isis sin velos. El primer volumen, En contra de la ciencia exacta, sin duda te interesará mucho, pero no creo que sea igual con el segundo, En contra de la teología y por la religión. Yo conozco lo sincera y devota que eres, cuán clara y pura es tu fe, y mi sola esperanza es que puedas entender que mis libros no son escritos en contra de la religión, ni en contra del Cristo, sino en contra de la cobardía e hipocresía de aquellos que matan, queman y asesinan en nombre del Todopoderoso Hijo de Dios. Yo creo en Dios invisible y universal, en el abstracto espíritu de Dios y no en una divinidad antropomórfica. Yo creo en la inmortalidad del espíritu divino de cada hombre, pero no en la inmortalidad de todo hombre, pues yo creo en la justicia de Dios. Cada uno debe de ganar el reino de los cielos o el reino de Dios por la fuerza. Eso es por buenos trabajos y por una vida pura. Pero de creer que cualquier villano, ateísta, asesino, por el solo hecho de exclamar en el supremo momento de su lucha y por miedo, yo creo en Dios, pueda estar próximo al bueno y al hombre de rectitud, en esto no puedo creer. Claramente, la señora Blavatsky expone que ella no está en contra de la religión ni del Cristo, sino de la crueldad, la injusticia y la hipocresía en el nombre de Dios. Entonces nos dice que Dios en el hombre, su espíritu divino, es asequible solo a los justos y puros de corazón, indicando que es fomentando esa comunión del alma humana con el espíritu divino lo que hace inmortal al hombre, y no alimentando su parte egoísta y ruin. Y ahora dice, voy al banco de un lago, tomo una piedra y la tiro en el agua. Esa piedra produce un disturbio de acuerdo a su tamaño. Una ola crea otra, la cual crea otra. Las ondulaciones circulares se propagan una tras otra y el movimiento del agua se transmite a la atmósfera, a las capas inferiores. Desde arriba hacia abajo, fuerzas hormigas surgen y hasta donde puede llegar la vista, este movimiento se propaga de un átomo a otro y continúa mucho más allá, de un estrato a otro, desapareciendo en el espacio infinito e inmensurable. Un impulso es dado, y ese impulso, como los doctores conocen, es eterno en sus efectos. Este es el cuadro de cada crimen, de cada mala acción, así como de cada buena acción. Me pregunto, ¿puede la divinidad, que ha por siempre creado las leyes inmutables en el mundo físico-moral, inclusive si se puede hacer, arrastrar el curso de esas leyes, removiendo aquello que una vez tuvo lugar? No, señora. El perdón de los pecados, incluyendo la aniquilación de los efectos del crimen, no es la justicia suprema de acuerdo al punto de vista teosófico. Como es de ver, HPV está describiendo la ley de karma, la cual es justa y trae los efectos correspondientes a los actos que fueron encausados, ya sean estos del mundo físico, atómico y metafísico, así como de los niveles ético-moral y psicológicos en el hombre. También dice, una manifestación ha sido traída por la aparición en la tierra del Dios hecho hombre. Ecohomo, este es el hombre, síguelo, camina por su camino. Mientras él viva, pregúntale por su ayuda. En esto creo absolutamente, no en la ayuda del gran Dios. ¿Qué eres tú en su mirada, sino su hijo, representando a la humanidad, la que es crucificada a cada momento por su maldad? Él, en letras mayúsculas, nos ha mostrado su camino, no en sinagogas o en templos como los fariseos de antaño, sino en su propio templo, en la profundidad de nuestros corazones, de cada uno de nosotros. ¿No sabéis que sois el templo de Dios? Preguntó San Pablo. Esto es sacado de los Corintios 3. Traten, dice Blavatsky, de limpiar sus pecados por el bien hacer, y no a través de inútiles penitencias, sino con ellos. Y la ley de venganza se apartará de ustedes. Traten seriamente durante su frágil vida de unirse íntimamente a su propio Dios personal, con su espíritu divino, y entonces su alma se tornará inmortal. Pero si rompen su vínculo con él, entonces se apartan del mensajero de Dios, el Cristo, y él se alejará de ustedes. El camino hacia ese verdadero ser interno y espiritual está dentro de nosotros, en las profundidades de nuestros corazones. Busquémoslo ahí. Pongámosle atención. Oigámoslo y seamos justos, pues así aprenderemos a trabajar con la ley de karma y no en contra de ella. Así lo hizo Jesús Cristo el Nazareno, y así lo podemos hacer cada uno de nosotros, porque nosotros todos tenemos el Cristo en nosotros. Bueno, ahora aquí HPV desenvuelve estos mismos temas que hemos estado considerando a través de preguntas y respuestas y de una manera más didáctica en la clave de la teosofía escrita años más tarde, en 1889, o sea, 18 años más tarde que hice Sin Velos. Como primer tema, el origen común del hombre, básicamente nos dice que la humanidad es una misma esencia, y siendo esa esencia una, infinita, increada y eterna, ya la llamemos Dios o naturaleza, nada puede, por lo tanto, afectar a una nación, un hombre, sin afectar a las demás naciones, porque todos venimos de ese mismo origen y a ese mismo origen todos volvemos. También ella nos habla sobre la fraternidad como una realidad en la naturaleza y la fraternidad como ideal a realizar por cada hombre. También sobre la unidad de las religiones. Y esto es importante, que las religiones, se deja todo lo que es el aspecto de supersticiones, de creencias falsas, se libran las religiones de todo eso, pues se encontrará que la esencia de las verdades común que las une es la misma. Y eso es, por eso es que las religiones tienen esa unidad en la verdad. Y aunque sus vestimentas sean diferentes, están señalando hacia esa misma verdad. Volviendo al tema del karma, y para recapitular lo que se había estado considerando anteriormente con la carta de la tía, que le hizo a la tía Nadir Fadir, nos dice Blavatsky en la clave de la teosofía. En la filosofía verdadera, cada acción física tiene su efecto moral y eterno. Perjudicar a un hombre causándole un daño corporal, pensaréis que su pena y su sufrimiento no pueden en modo alguno afectar a sus prójimos, y mucho menos a hombres de otras naciones. Nosotros afirmamos que sí lo hará a su debido tiempo. Decimos por consiguiente que mientras cada hombre no comprenda y acepte como una verdad axiomática que perjudicando a otros, nos perjudicamos no solo a nosotros mismos, sino a la larga a toda la humanidad, no son posibles en la tierra sentimientos fraternales tales como los que predicaron todos los grandes reformadores, sobre todo Buda y Jesús. Entonces la fraternidad debe ser la expresión más natural en las relaciones humanas, al comprender que todos compartimos un origen divino común. Si se comprende que la vida una es una unidad inteligente y que está entretejida con las leyes del karma y de la evolución, no le haríamos daño a nadie. En otras palabras, la evolución de una conciencia superior en el hombre debe de ir mano a mano con la realización del ideal de la fraternidad. Ahora, pues vamos a ver algunos de los más destacados acontecimientos en la vida de HPB que muestran su sensibilidad y altruismo, su preparación y su entrega al servicio de los hermanos mayores, de los grandes seres, y por compasión a la sufriente humanidad. Madame Blavatsky arribó en Nueva York el 7 de julio de 1873 sin fondos personales, habiendo intercambiado su pasaje de primera clase por uno más económico y de tercera, para poderle comprar los pasajes a una pobre mujer que había sido estafada y a sus pequeños hijos. Aunque ella tenía 23 mil francos en su baúl confiados por su maestro, se ganaba la vida trabajando para un hacedor de corbatas. Un tanto después, bajo las órdenes de su maestro, llevó este dinero a la ciudad de Buffalo, New York, y se lo dio a un hombre desconocido justo a tiempo para impedirle que se suicidara. En 1874 se le ordenó que fuera a la granja de Eddie en Chittenden. Esta era la escena de varios fenómenos ocultos que estaban siendo investigados por el coronel Olcott. Junto con él, Nueva York fundó la Sociedad Teosófica. Su libro, Isis sin velo, una magnífica denuncia al materialismo abrazo de la religión y la ciencia, fue publicado en el 1877, como habíamos dicho anteriormente. Ella envió las primeras ganancias de las ventas de su libro, junto al dinero recibido por varios artículos publicados en periódicos y jornales rusos, a la Cruz Roja, para ayudar a sus compatriotas heridos en la guerra ruso-turca. Blavatsky fue alumna de Moscheles, un compositor y pianista virtuoso bohemio judío-alemán de Praga. Y cuando joven en Londres, acompañada por su padre, tocó al piano una pieza de Schumann para tres pianos, en un concierto de caridad que dio con Madame Clara Schumann y Madame Arabelle Goddard, ambas pianistas concertistas de renombre internacional. El coronel Olcott nos dice de la musicalidad de HPB. Elena era una pianista espléndida, tocaba con una sensibilidad especial y con una expresión que era verdaderamente magnífica. Sus manos eran manos ideales y modelo para un escultor, nunca vistas, especialmente cuando volaban sobre el teclado con tal alcance y produciendo mágicas melodías. En algunas ocasiones, cuando estaba bajo la influencia de uno de los maestros y tocaba el piano, era indescriptiblemente grandioso el escucharla. Se sentaba al anochecer sin que nadie estuviera en el cuarto excepto yo. En esos momentos de tranquilidad y de paz, ella sacaba del piano dulces tonos e improvisaciones que me hacían imaginarme que estaba escuchando a los coristas celestiales o gandharvas. Era la armonía del cielo. Se nos dice que algunos maestros adeptos están detrás de todo movimiento artístico que promueve la sensibilidad, la armonía y la elevación espiritual de sus congéneres. Y como pueden ver, pues Blavatsky era uno de ellos que participaba pues, de esta sensibilidad artística, de este talento de poder tocar el piano e inspirarse de una manera bella. En julio 8 de 1878 se hizo ciudadana americana. Más tarde ese mismo año, Olcott y ella se dirigieron a la India, llegando a Bombay en febrero de 1879. En 1880, los dos fundadores hicieron una gira por Sri Lanka, Ceilán, promoviendo el budismo, y se hicieron budistas el 25 de mayo de 1880. En 1882, la sede de la Sociedad Teosófica fue trasladada a Niyar Madras, actualmente Chennai. Más tarde, se dirigió a Alemania. En Würzburg, Alemania, trabajó entonces en La Doctrina Secreta, su obra maestra, que de acuerdo a la condesa Westminster, sus verdaderos autores son los hermanos Adeptus. Esta era una confiada de Blavatsky que trabajaba con ella en La Doctrina Secreta. Como con Ise sin velos, los hermanos Adeptus recogieron el material y se lo pasaron ante la visión interna de HPV, la cual fue la receptora y escritora. En 1887, estando en Ostend, se enfermó gravemente, pero se recuperó milagrosamente, pues eligió trabajar por algunos años más para completar La Doctrina Secreta, aunque en un ya sufrido cuerpo físico. Fue invitada a ir a Londres, donde completó La Doctrina Secreta, y la Sociedad Teosófica de Londres se volvió el centro de trabajo teosófico para toda Europa. En 1888, los dos primeros volúmenes de La Doctrina Secreta fueron publicados. Ella murió el 8 de mayo de 1891, a los 60 años, sin antes haber escrito también La Voz del Silencio, La Clave de la Teosofía, El Glosario Teosófico y muchos más artículos y libros. El secreto del extraordinario poder de HPV en producir cambios en la vida de todos alrededor de ella se resume en lo que Olcott, Coronel Olcott, nos dice sobre sus cualidades. Increíble conocimiento oculto y poderes para producir fenómenos, así como su relación directa con los maestros de la sabiduría. Ella produjo la taza de té, una tetera china, para diferentes celebraciones y eventos que ocurrieron en su vida, pero aún más importante, ella era el canal que servía de precipitación, de precipitar las cartas de los maestros. Brillantes talentos, especialmente como conversadora con sus logros sociales, numerosos viajes iniciáticos y extraordinarias aventuras. Todos ustedes saben, quizás sí, quizás no, pero ella tuvo su viaje iniciático especialmente al Tíbet, donde recibió el conocimiento de la sabiduría divina con los maestros de la sabiduría. Comprensión sobre los problemas de filología, orígenes raciales, la base fundamental de las religiones y las claves a viejos misterios y simbolismo. La inquebrantable consagración de sí misma a los grandes seres irradiaba de la vida de HPV, siendo por siempre conocida como la que nos trae la luz del siglo XIX. Digo yo que ella es la luz estrella, no solamente del siglo XIX y del siglo pasado, sino del siglo presente y de siglos por venir. Y para concluir, unas palabras sobre la vida diaria, la voz del silencio y la escala de hoy. Palabras sobre la vida diaria de los escritos compilados, volumen 7. Aquellos de ustedes que han de conocerse a sí mismos en el espíritu de la verdad, aprendan a vivir solos, aún en medio de las grandes multitudes que pueden ocasionalmente rodearles. Busquen la comunión y el trato solamente con ese Dios dentro de su propia alma. Escuchen solamente el elogio y la culpabilidad de esa deidad, de que esa deidad le señala que jamás yace separada de su yo verdadero, porque es en realidad Dios mismo, llamado conciencia superior. Pongan sin demora sus buenas intenciones en práctica, sin dejar jamás que ninguna de ellas se quede solo como una intención. Y mientras tanto, no espere recompensa ni reconocimiento para lo bueno que haya hecho. La recompensa y el reconocimiento están en usted mismo y le son inseparables. Y es su propio ser interno el único que puede apreciarlas en su grado y valor verdaderos. El alma bien intencionada, aquella que es amable y humilde, entre otras cosas, puede aprender a recogerse en sí misma y llegar a escuchar la voz de su conciencia superior. La teosofía solo puede encontrar expresión en un código generalizado de vida, completamente impregnado con el espíritu de la tolerancia, la caridad y el amor fraternal. Su sociedad como un cuerpo tiene una tarea ante la cual, a menos que ello se realice con discreción suprema, causará que el mundo del indiferente y el egoísta se alcen armas contra ella. La teosofía tiene que combatir la intolerancia, el prejuicio, la ignorancia y el egoísmo, escondidos bajo el manto de la hipocresía. Tiene que dispersar toda la luz que pueda de la antorcha de la verdad que se le confía a sus servidores. Ustedes son trabajadores libres y voluntarios en los campos de la verdad, y como tal, no deben colocar obstáculos en los senderos que llevan a ese campo. Entonces, nosotros que apreciamos la teosofía, trabajemos con entusiasmo e inegoísmo, ofreciéndoles a otros las mismas oportunidades que se nos han dado, compartiendo lo que sabemos y lo que nos inspira a ser mejores seres humanos. La voz del silencio nos dice: ten perseverancia como aquel que sufre eternamente. Tus sombras viven y se desvanecen. Aquello que en ti vivirá siempre, aquello que en ti conoce, porque es el conocimiento, no está dotado de vida efímera. Es el hombre que fue, es y será, y para quien jamás sonará la hora. Los cuerpos físicos o personalidades son denominados sombras y como tales son efímeros, están sujetos al cambio, al nacimiento, el crecimiento, la maduración y la muerte. La mente, manas, el principio pensante o yo del hombre, tiene conexión con el conocimiento, o sea, con ese conocimiento verdadero y espiritual, con ese conocimiento mismo, puesto que los yos humanos son llamados manasaputras, los hijos de la mente universal. El principio pensante, o yo del hombre, es esa alma humana a la cual hemos estado considerando. Es el manas o mente en el hombre, enfocada hacia la verdad, hacia el entendimiento y la iluminación espiritual. Es hija o hijo de las buenas obras. Es el ego que evoluciona y reencarna en el ser humano y el que recibirá la justicia de sus actos meritorios, si no pudo ser en esta vida, pues en una vida futura. Por último, la escala de oro nos dice: vida limpia, mente abierta, corazón puro, intelecto despierto, percepción espiritual sin velos, afecto fraternal para con el condiscípulo, etcétera, etcétera, etcétera. Todos pasos muy importantes para poder ascender hacia ese templo de la sabiduría divina. Si estos pasos son tomados conscientemente y puestos en práctica, iluminarán verdaderamente nuestras mentes y corazones. Por tanto, perseveremos en este camino de la verdad. Y ahora damos gracias a Madame Blavatsky, la fervorosa maestra madre de la teosofía, por habernos dejado este conocimiento de la sabiduría divina. Gracias, hermanos y hermanas.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ananya Sriram Rajan. I'm here to give the TOS report for Argentina, Brazil, Costa Rica, Mexico, and the United States. The National Director of the TOS in Argentina is Marcela Riado. Her goal is to make the TOS more visible among the members and sympathizers of the Theosophical Society in Argentina, as well as to other Hispanic-speaking countries in South and Central America. In addition, she hopes to continue to weave fraternal ties between coordinators and collaborators and to try to add more interested parties to the work. Ushuaia is the most southern city in Argentina. It belongs to the province of Tierra del Fuego. Its economy is largely supported by the tourism, so the pandemic has had a severe impact on income, resulting in much poverty. Before the pandemic began, there were 6 free dining rooms in Ushuaia. Today, there are 17. Many people, especially those involved in tourism, as well as factory workers, have had their working hours reduced or have been out of work. Others, like some backpackers, are stranded on the island because they do not have the means to return home. During this year, TOS raised funds to provide 150 meals to Emmanuel Dining Room for people in need. They also bought 63 pairs of shoes that are suitable for the climatic conditions of the city for the students of the Ernesto Sabato Provincial School. Due to the economic difficulties of the area, students cannot afford these shoes and therefore stop attending school. So far, 29 pairs have been delivered. Casilda is a city in the province of Santa Fe. The TOS group there made several donations to organizations in great need, such as the Association of Volunteer Firefighters and the Hospital of Belson in the province of Rio Negro. This was due to the fires in the Andean region. Animal shelters of Casilda, Rosario, and Espinillos were also supported. Monies were also donated to the Casilda Scholarship Association to provide financial support so that children of both primary and secondary schools can continue studying. Espinillas is a rural area located about 15 kilometers from the city of Rio Cuatro. It belongs to the province of Cordoba. In Espinillas, the retreat house Our Lady and All Angels is on the property of the Liberal Catholic Church. It houses the Espinillas shelter, home for 21 dogs and 7 cats that have been rescued from the street. In the city of Buenos Aires, donations from members and supporters helped the work carried out by the cultural house Victor Jara, whose activities are always dedicated to art and culture. Donations of money, everyday household items, clothing, non-perishable food, and toys were provided to help the neighborhoods. There were also donations made to the animal shelter, Companions of the Soul. The meetings of the Healing League are being held by various coordinators in Casilda, Rosario, Rio Cuatro, Cordoba, and San Rafael. Since the end of August, Argentina has joined the Prayer of Healing, coordinated by Sister Lucila Garcia of TOS Mexico. This brings together participants from Argentina, Costa Rica, and Mexico. Marcela Riado would like to thank all those who silently and anonymously collaborate with our human brothers and animal brothers and plants, building a life that is more equalitarian and respectful throughout the world. In Brasilia, Brazil, several campaigns were done to raise money for various causes. A campaign was done to raise money for a young boy named Lucas so he could have eye surgery. Financial support was raised to help needy TS members during the pandemic. Veterinarian treatment was given to a dog, and money was raised for that as well. Raffle sale campaigns were organized to help support the health treatment of a TS brother. And a campaign was done to raise money for a retired secretary of the TS office to help with the expenses of her brother's funeral. From July 2020 to August 2021, TOS Arts continued organizing the weekly Theosophy and Art by Zoom, which began in April 2020. It is broadcasted on the National TS Brazil channel on YouTube on Saturday evenings from 7:30 to 9. During relaxed and joyful nights, theosophists and sympathizers from various places in Brazil and around the world have met to celebrate poetry, music, dance, literature, visual arts, and all artistic expressions through soirees, lectures, and panels. A list of approximately 50 videos made from the recording of the meetings can be accessed through the following link. TOS Arts also implemented and completed the project of the book Theosophy and Verses, an anthology, published by the Theosophical Press in Brazil. The work was launched in July 2021 through an online soiree. The authors, all members of TS in Brazil, read some of the poems published in the book, all inspired by walking the spiritual path. A highlight in the schedule of the year was the participation in the 40th Summer School of the TS Brazil, which took place on January 29th and 30th in 2021. TOS Art, as it happened in other seminars, promoted a cultural event to close out the two nights of the seminar. There were more than 40 performances by poetry, more than 40 performances of poetry, music, dance, and visual arts conducted by members who are dedicated to the activities of TOS Arts. In Bragança Paulista, the Theosophical Lodge Alea contributes to the work of the Theosophical Order of Service with the healing session Meditation Group for Healing. For safety reasons, during the pandemic in 2020, the meditation was posted through WhatsApp, joining the group together every Friday evening at 6 p.m. Due to the difficulties of some members concerning the established time, there are four different time zones in Brazil, the president of the lodge decided to let the meditation for healing be done daily at any time. Members are free to add new names to the list of requests for people who need it, its vibration being worked day by day. Thus, this work continues to this present moment. In João Pessoa, the Esperança Lodge is conducting a small social project that consists of the following actions. Since May 2021, the monthly donations of the members of the lodge are being used to purchase organic food from farmers in the various regions of the state of Paraíba. The purchased food, fruits, vegetables, and roots of the season are given to the Padre Zé Institute. This is a welfare entity in the city that receives the most diverse donations and maintains a nursing home, hospital, and an industrial kitchen, where it prepares and distributes meals for patients and the homeless population. With this action, the Hope Theosophical Lodge, through TOS, intends to help the entire social chain, from the small farmer in the field to the needy people in the city, buying and donating organic, vegetarian, and healthy food. Since November 2018, a telephone service in Juiz de Fora for emotional support and prayer is offered by Espiritus Center. The service is offered for 2.5 hours every 2 weeks. Since February 2021, the TOS helps with training workers for the CVV On Call, a national telephone service program for emotional support. The structure and organization of the TOS group was officially started in April 2021. Development of a social project called Franco Amor disseminates information about emotional support services throughout the country, as well as the search for volunteers for these institutions, and provides information about mental health, quality of life, focusing on the integral human being. The TOS group printed and distributed 300 copies of the article Statute of Compassion on the Streets of Juiz de Fora, which was published by the Sophia magazine, number 77. It also participated in a Lotus social project, raising funds and delivering computer products to underprivileged children and teenagers. The president of the NGO Animal and Nature in Juiz de Fora has today under its guardianship 50 animals and an office to care for them. Supported by various contributions from TOS supporters, the office is also a source of funding for the association's expenses. Due to the pandemic, the healing service in Rio de Janeiro was reactivated through a WhatsApp group. It meets every 15 days on Wednesdays. A TOS group was started to share information related to TOS principles in the areas of health, animal welfare, TOS campaigns, and the cultural programs. In November 2020, a Christmas campaign donated 120 food baskets to the community of Jardim Gamache. In March 2021, 834 bottles of water were supplied to a community of Jardim Gamache. 3 trucks were also supplied to transport water to fill the water tanks of the houses. In June, a donation was made to Grupo Redes No Quintal, a choir composed of homeless people and maintained by the conductor Ricardo Branco de Vasconcelos. 10 pairs of famous rubber slippers, 30 bars of soap, and a pair of glasses for a choir boy were also donated. In July, the TOS worked with the Spiritus group Demetrius, purchasing and delivering blankets to the homeless people. 700 reals were raised. 2 brothers from the Nirvana Lodge participated personally in the delivery, which was made in 2 days. The TOS group in Costa Rica helped support the opening of the TOS in Mexico. They continue to do healing service via Zoom on Sundays. Food and other items are given to people in need. The healing service for Costa Rica is held every Wednesday at 6 p.m. At the same time, brothers from other countries of the Americas where it does not exist are invited to participate, such as in Paraguay, the Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, and others. Donations are also contributed to animal shelters. Gifts and clothes were donated to 75 disadvantaged children for the Christmas of 2020. In Jalapa, Veracruz, food supplements are donated to the Mariana Sayago Hospice. The supplements help the elderly strengthen their immune system and help them maintain their weight. In Casa del Sol Puebla, clothing and school utensils were donated for the Casa del Sol, a foster home for abandoned children. In Puebla, two doctors give free consultation to the homeless, drug addicts, and alcoholics at the Alcance Victorias Association in Puebla. In Tuxtla Gutierrez, Chiapas, food supplements and diaper donations are made for Emilio, an 8-year-old with several genetic ailments. In Acozacuatla, Chiapas, children are being taught how to respect birds. With the help of an ornithologist and two nature photographers, a bird watching and identification workshop was held for children. The children were invited to appreciate the bird's beauty and importance and encouraged not to hunt them with slingshots. Follow-up workshops are already planned now with the support from the National Commission for Protected Areas. In Tuxtla Gutierrez, Chiapas, food donations for neighborhoods with scarce resources was also made. 40 meals are delivered weekly to low-income families. These donations are made by the Vega Castellanos family. In Guanajuato, a group of neighbors take care of the public park, watering and fertilizing the plants and trees, painting the benches, and placing luminaries. Painting and creating children's games is also included. Neighbors make the donations and they work together. In Mexico City, a group of volunteers rescue dogs and cats from the streets. Animals are sterilized, medically cared for, and fed while awaiting adoption. The shelter is maintained by volunteers with the help of small donations. A healing prayer is held weekly with the collaboration of brothers and sisters from the US, Costa Rica, Argentina, and Mexico since July 25th. Prayer has no borders. It unites us and reminds us of universal brotherhood. Due to COVID restrictions, the TOS United States continues to work online. A series of online programs that centered on our relationship with the natural world were held. Billy Topatate, an Apache medicine woman, kicked off the series with a prayer and a talk about our need to listen to Mother Earth. A presentation on the words of wisdom from the book Braiding Sweetgrass by Robin Wall Kimmerer, a scientist and a member of the Potawatomi Nation, was also given a month later. And yet another month later, another presentation was made on the book, The Hidden Life of Trees by Peter Wallaban. All programs were well attended nationally and internationally. The TOS US continues supporting the Ogallala Lakota Nursing School Scholarship. This year, the Ogallala Scholarship recipient was Bethany Ayota. The TOS also continues supporting the Golden Link College through the Kern Matching Grant. The healing networks for both humans and animals remains a popular project. This year, the Animal Healing Network received over 90 different names of animals and its owners. It now has 26 different healers, and it is in its 7th year of functioning. Despite COVID, the TOS support continues to award different organizations with its grants. $7,000 in grants were awarded to the following: the Lakota Waldorf School, the Midwest Homeless Veterans Shelter, the Waterkeeper Alliance, Feeding America, the TSA Prisoner Program, the Alcott Education Society for the Women's Training Institute, the Golden Link College, and Compassion and World Farming. The TOS US is proud to announce that it has endorsed the efforts of Back from the Brink, a campaign to end the prohibition and use of nuclear weapons. The TOS US continues to publicize its social issues and promote its work through its newsletter, One Heart. To sign up for the newsletter, go to www.theoservice.org. The TOS US would like to say gracias, thank you to the many who serve humanity through acts of kindness, love, generosity, and compassion. Every positive action, no matter how small, counts. A personal thank you to Regina Da Silva, whose efforts made this presentation possible. May all beings know peace.